Well, my guest, Ernesto Araújo, was President Bolsonaro's foreign minister until earlier this year. He stands accused of complicity in the government's failure to procure sufficient vaccines and of putting ideology before public health. Is that fair? Ernesto Araújo in Connecticut, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you very much, Stephen. Great to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you on the show. It's about, well, roughly 9 months since you resigned as Foreign Minister of Brazil. That's given you a little bit of time to reflect. And with that reflection, do you now acknowledge that COVID-19 and the handling of the pandemic has been a disaster for the Bolsonaro government?
No, not at all. What happened has been the weaponization of COVID and everything that came with it by all the forces that are against President Bolsonaro's original project of basically ending the kleptocracy, the system that has run Brazil for a long time. So those people want to keep the system, want to keep stealing, want to keep their network of bribes and corruption, and they used COVID all along in order to weaken President Bolsonaro's government, and to a large extent they managed. Today the corrupt system is much stronger than it was at the beginning of the pandemic, and it has to do with the change in foreign policy that President Bolsonaro undertook after I left, under the pressure of that corrupt system.
It's a strange way of looking at what has happened in Brazil as a result of the pandemic to accuse the opponents of Mr. Bolsonaro of weaponizing the pandemic. I mean, the pandemic for Brazilians is a real fact. It has killed more than 600,000 people. Millions and millions have been infected. And famously, your former boss, Mr. Bolsonaro, dismissed it as nothing more than the sniffles. And to this very day, he refuses to get a vaccination. It suggests to many Brazilians that from start to finish, he has completely failed to prioritize protecting his own people.
That's not true. That's not true. There are many questions there. First, most of the, almost all the authority in practice for dealing with the pandemic was transferred from the federal government to the state governments by decisions of the Supreme Court in Brazil, which today acts as de facto head of state in Brazil. Everything goes to the Supreme Court and they decide everything.
I'm just wondering whether the reason you are denying the culpability of Mr. Bolsonaro is because it also gets to the culpability of yourself. You will know that the parliamentary committee investigating the government's response has recommended charges, very serious charges, against Mr. Bolsonaro, but has also recommended charges against you. They want you indicted, and I'm looking here formally at the wording, they want you indicted for your strategic errors in conducting diplomacy, which hindered relations with China and had a material impact on the import of necessary supplies. They also cited your part in an institutional disinformation campaign which worsened the pandemic. Are you ready to face those charges?
Because they're absolutely not true. This parliamentary commission was a sham. This is also a political instrument that wanted to just to weaken President Bolsonaro. They didn't find any material evidence for anything that they say, because that's not true. It's basically a rhetorical device.
Well, forgive me, but they claim that there is clear evidence that the stance you took toward China, in particular labeling the coronavirus the communavirus, with a particular emphasis on your notion that it was part of some sort of communist conspiracy to ensure that big global governance was imposed on Brazil, that, they say, led to China going slow on supplying vaccinations and ingredients for vaccination to Brazil.
It's not true. That's not true. When I left office, we had already vaccination available basically at the same rate as European countries that had started vaccination earlier and who did not depend on Chinese supplies. Back in late March, if I'm not mistaken, Brazil was around 9% of population already vaccinated. European countries had basically 10 or 12%. So and we had much higher vaccination rates than most developing countries.
But hang on, I want you to deal with the specifics, because the specifics are important. I mean, did you think it was clever or wise to label it the communavirus?
Yeah, why did I label it the communavirus? And I bet you didn't read the article where I that I titled that way. I showed the book that was published by a communist Marxist author, Slavoj Žižek, saying that COVID was great for communism, because together with the virus, the coronavirus, an ideological virus would take place, and which would transform societies in the way that communists want. And he says, oh, you want to look at communism in the present and in the future?
Right.
Look at the WHO decisions, for example. So he clearly associates the globalist takeover that comes with
Right. So just to be clear, then,
I thought
perhaps it was an unfair portrayal to see you as somebody who saw the WHO as part of a sort of globalist communist enterprise. But maybe you do. Yeah. Is that what you really think?
It's what Marxists and communists tend to think. I do think.
If I'm not wrong, Karl Marx was not involved in the creation of the WHO. I'm really struggling to understand what you're even talking about.
I'm talking about it because Marxist authors today, very influential Marxist authors, talk about WHO and other multilateral institutions as an instrument to create what they consider to be the communism of the 21st century.
I'm looking at the impact your running of the foreign ministry and Mr. Bolsonaro's running of the presidency has had on Brazilians. I'm looking, for example, at the response of 300 of your own colleagues. Now, these aren't kleptocrats or corrupt Brazilians who are worth millions of dollars, but these are 300 of your colleagues inside the foreign ministry who signed an open letter denouncing you, their boss, in March 2021, talking about the serious harm that you were doing to Brazil's interests, demolishing Brazil's international reputation, putting Brazilian lives at risk, vandalizing relations with China and the US during this terrible pandemic. That was the judgment of your own colleagues in your own ministry.
Yes. Well, first of all, 300, I don't know if there are 3 or 3,000, because they're anonymous and they say there are 300, but they were not brave enough to put their names under that sort of garbage. This is all nonsense that they're saying there. And yes, unfortunately, a big part of Brazilian diplomatic institutions, I mean, the Brazilian foreign ministry, very traditional institutions, along the decades has become very cozy with the kleptocracy. They have become kind of an instrument of enforcing and strengthening the alliances, the international alliances of that kleptocracy, which is one of them is China, another is the multilateralism ideology, multilateralist ideology that is around the world today. So yes, it's natural that some people, or many people there, feel uneasy with a foreign policy that was based on the interests of the Brazilian people, the interests of transforming Brazil from a kleptocracy into a democracy with the right international connections. They have not pointed any concrete example to substantiate what they say.
Well, I wonder if you're
just retarded. Yeah, well, just retarded.
I just wonder whether you feel that your foreign policy strategy, which was very loud, vocal support for Donald Trump, very loud vocal condemnation of China, whether you think that that has been strategically wise for Brazil?
Yes, of course. Well, for the first time in many decades, we had a strategic foreign policy. Before I was there and after I left, now we're back to a mediocre foreign policy that only thinks about today's gain, and even that is not coming. For the time
but
I was
you,
there,
you,
people
you,
always
you described you described Donald Trump yes. as the savior of the West, even after the assault on the Capitol on January 6, 2021, after Trump had lost the election. You defended the right of people to demonstrate, and you said it was wrong to characterize, quote, good citizens as fascists. It seems to me, a guy who was determined to go to the very end in your support of Donald Trump. And the fact is, he's no longer in power. Joe Biden's in power. Joe Biden has refused to even make a phone call to President Bolsonaro. You have soured and toxified relations between Brasilia and Washington.
That's not true. No, that's not true. I've been a very totally wrong interpretation. Why we were close with the United States under Donald Trump? Because we share the same values. We want a world of sovereign nations and not a world dominated by transnational elites and by a communist dictatorship such as China. And we're working together with the U.S. and we were putting together very robust ideas about how to deal with that. Together with a great guy, Mike Pompeo, then Secretary of State.
But with respect, none of these people are in power anymore. And isn't the truth? Thank you very much for joining me on Hard Talk.
Thank you.